day. So
I just got the signal from Mr. Engineer. We are on the air. Welcome to NJ Discover, special edition live radio show. And before we jump into things, I'm going to do that station ID. So you're listening to NJ Discover Radio. To find out more, go to njdiscover.com or follow us on Facebook, NJ Discover production page. Or you can also follow us on Twitter at NJ Discover. And it gives me, as always, and you're very close to me. Gee. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce my co-host, Tara Jean Vitale.
Thank you very much, Calvin. And obviously, I'm so happy to be here again with you tonight on our wonderful show, Calvin Schwartz, my host.
Well, thank you. We have truly an amazing show here tonight with a packed studio with some amazing people from Nick Clemens and friends, and we'll talk about that momentarily. But we have to, what we do every week, we digress and go back to our childhood, you and I, and we do one of those things that we used to do in second grade. What did I do this weekend? So do you want to?
Okay, I'll go first.
Go first.
I went to see Danny Aiello perform at the Supper Club, Tim McLoone Supper Club in Asbury Park, and he was wonderful. He sang some holiday Christmas songs, but my favorite was Lady in Red. He sang Lady in Red to his wife, who was sitting in the chair.
That's cool.
And it was just beautifully romantic. He was wonderful. And I got to meet with him afterwards. I gave him a big hug. I actually posted that on Facebook.
I saw that. I saw that. It was great.
He's so sweet. He's such a good man. So what about you? What did you do this weekend?
A lot of stuff. On top of my list, you and I participated with some friends of NJ Discover in a seance.
Oh, yes.
Conducted by one of the country's leading psychics. We do this, and I'm looking at our guests. Some are looking at me strangely. So I'm going to say we are reporters, and we do these things to learn about the world.
To experience
and to learn. So we did a seance with Jane Doty, one of the country's leading psychics.
Yeah.
And it was extremely emotional. We put together a collection of people who are interested in that. And, again, it was all to learn about the world
that
we live in.
And she doesn't really hear the spirits that have passed. She sees images, and it was amazing how she would see these images, and then someone would say, that's my dad. You know, at this one point, she says, I see candy. I see these candies wrapped and in jars, and I see them. And this woman says, my father owned a candy shop, and he used to have these rows of candies on the counter, and she was like, it's him.
She was pretty dead on. The spirit that's been in my life, it's an old spirit, and she kind of does more recent spirits. So,
yeah.
But I was semi-fulfilled. But I must say what happened to me on the way home, because that just
spooky.
Blew really beyond
Well, they say you could bring ghosts home with you.
Well, I did. So I had a car full of people. I had
as
my
witnesses.
Sister. As witnesses. I had my sister. I had a teacher from Marlboro, and I had Karen, who's an author. And so we're driving home, and I had to drive my sister off at the train station. I knew where I was going. So I pulled out my Garmin from the charger, and it normally would give me an indication to shut off. So I pulled it out, and my Garmin wouldn't shut off. So I pulled the other plug out. My Garmin wouldn't – it just kept talking and talking.
And they say that, spirits.
And they're talking. So there is no explanation for that. And while I'm fussing and trying to shut this thing off, it wouldn't shut off. The car radio goes on. It starts playing folk music.
Oh, my gosh.
And I didn't turn the car radio on.
That's bizarre.
So that's all I have to say. That's all I have to say about that. That's actually a quote from Kennedy. This is what I have to say about that. And now
– Forrest Gump say that?
Excuse me?
Forrest Gump.
I think he did.
Yeah.
I think he did. So that's it. No more banter. We have too much to do. So I'm going to introduce my friend Nick Clemens. You and I got put together by the stars and the moon and the sun in Asbury Park 2 summers ago, and it was a wondrous night because we became friends. So, Nick, I'd love you to introduce yourself and introduce everybody's here for this big man's reunion night.
Well, hi everybody. It's great to have me. Thanks for having me here, and I've known Cal for a little bit, and it's good to show the love and support that he has for the area. And Tara, great seeing you too.
Yes.
And great place you got here. I love the studio. Nice and warm and cozy. tonight's a special night for me. I'm just so glad to have a lot of good friends from my father's past and his future. And he's still with us in his spirit, and we try to keep his image alive and his legacy alive. And that's what we're doing with the great people I have, support I have with a lot of friends. We have some guys from the Big Man's West past that we're going to bring up for our show January 11th. And one of them is George McMorrow is going to be here, and he's going to tell a few stories. We're glad to see George around. And we also have Joe Bonanno's here and from the Godsons. And we also have the impeccable Mr. J.T. Bowen here.
Good evening.
We also have a good friend of mine, Mike Galicia, is going to play some songs for us with us. And also we have Daryl Way, very good friend from the past, a good friend of the Bangs. And we're just happy to have everyone here tonight.
And it's festive. It's Christmas. and we're going to be talking about a big party that's coming up on January 11th. So why don't, because we're really here for Clarence, so why don't you and I talk a little bit about Clarence. Why don't you say a few words about Clarence growing up in Norfolk, your grandfather?
My father was a man larger than life, and that spirit and that energy came from my grandfather. My grandfather was a really hardworking man. He was a longshoreman. He used massive hands, and they used those hands to start a business, a fishery, and down in Norfolk and Chesapeake, and had a farm, and was able to provide for his family. Back in those days, it was pretty hard for a man of color to actually do the things he did. He was a very great communicator. He was a man of the church, he was able to put lessons of hard work. And one thing that always I harp on, loyalty, honor, and respect. And he's definitely put that into our family's archives as far as what we see as good virtues and what we want to extend to our children, and we want to extend to others.
That's nice.
His farm was very, very successful, wasn't it?
It was pretty successful. I mean, he was able to grow a lot of food there. He was a man of the land. He loved to fish. He was a man that used what God gave him, and he worked very hard for it. He was a stalwart in the community too. That was very important to me, and what I found out, and that's the history part of going back and looking back. And we've had to do some of that kind of work with the project we're working on. So
was he a big guy like you and your dad?
He was a big man. He was about 6'2". Yeah. 6'2". Wasn't as big as my father, but he was a big man. But also had a great presence, he was larger than life.
Well, I think that's carried down down each generation. I got to tell you, Nick, you were larger than life, too.
We're trying.
So another interesting tidbit, one of my favorite Clarence stories, that I don't know how many people know, that Clarence actually was on the road to becoming a great football player. He was a great football player, and he was on his way to the NFL and could have been in the NFL today. Well, not today, but maybe that his whole life would have been completely different. So how did he not wind up in the NFL?
Well, I know he had a car accident, a very serious car accident. It was the year after he had finished the season. And he played on a line with Demison Boozer. Maryland Eastern Shore. It was one of the classic lines. They were a classic team at that time. And for a small school to compete with the teams they did compete with, and he got a lot of recognition. Art Shell's a Hall of Famer. But he was a good, great player. He was actually going to be drafted by Dallas Cowboys, and the Cleveland Indians were fighting for his rights. Because back then, there's no draft as there is today. There's no NFL draft where each team would have a selection. Each NFL team then had a region to pick from. And he was in the region where his team was going to be the Dallas Cowboys or the Browns, and they were making inquiries to make him a pick. And for that to happen back then, where there's no internet, there's no scouts, it wasn't a huge combine where people, players were showcased, were done, it was really done by word of mouth. And he was on his road to be a high pick. He was a great center, wow. Great hands, wow. And great, great feet from what I understand.
Another interesting tidbit about your dad that people don't know about. Tell us a story about the Maryland State Police and your dad.
Well, my parents had the opportunity to meet at college. That's pretty ironic because back then, you know, people of color didn't really have the opportunity. But in the 60s, 65, there was perfect opportunity for them because they were both music majors. And my godfather was dean of the college, William Heitch. It was a historically black school. The Maryland State Troopers wanted to pick someone that can actually go through the rigors of the training and also, you know, the degree of racism and have a strong personality, have great communication skills that can actually go through that. The same thing Jackie Robinson would have to go through going through baseball. But he was being groomed to be the first black state trooper. So that's a tidbit that I always have, hold dear, and people that really know about that also.
It's an amazing story. It's interesting because the earmarks of Clarence's greatness was seen way back then when they wanted to peg him to do that. In other words, the leadership and the stature,
the temperament,
the respect,
the
discipline. All of that was there then, and people saw it then. So I always thought that was an interesting story about your dad. And I get a kick out of this because a lot of people don't know this either, but when Clarence and your dad and your mom moved about 4 miles away from here then, and here we are talking about that.
Well, way before the playing all the years with Bruce and all the bands that he played with before Bruce, they lived at Jamesburg. He was a corrections officer for a while, and he was there at Jamesburg that he actually played and played a lot of music, and but also did a lot of good, helped a lot of kids out, was a good role model for them, and a lot of people still come up to me and tell me that they knew Mr. Clemens, as he was called, and he worked with my uncle at the time. My uncle got him the job there, and they were actually stationed there for a while, and that's where we lived in Jamesburg for quite some time.
Okay, and then here.
Yeah.
Yes, which is amazing. So I think this is a good juncture, because you wrote and performed a very powerful song called Old Man. And why don't you talk about the song, where it came from, the words, and then we'll play it.
Well, your father being a rock star, sometimes you have to take the best where you can get it. It's a hard life. There's a lot of sacrifices done in this business, and these guys will tell you. There's a lot of sacrifice in trying to do what you want to do. And, I wrote the song about just looking for that love and trying to find it. But once you do get it, to take the best part out of it and put that in the box and hold that love for it. And that's what the song's about.
When did you finish writing the song?
It was a poem that I wrote. And then all of a sudden the music came to me. But then, through the years, things had changed.
Okay.
And it went from, maybe a sad song to a liberating song because, and the point is you grow up. You get rid of all the pain, the suffering, the disappointments, and you fight for the good things that come out of it. And that's what I've always tried to do, find the good parts of my relationship with my father and make sure that I cherish those. And everything else is a wash, you know what I mean? It's really good life. Can't complain.
So we're going to segue, which is, one of my favorite words. Let's segue to hearing Old Man.
Old man walks through the day with the sun on his back. It seems as if the time is just washed away. And the gears don't lie, you see his youth is gone. He's looking for a way home, a way home. He tells times of old when he had to beg for steel. You see his life was so real, see there was misery. You see he did what he was told, respect was earned but not sold. Every man was just a man, not the color of his skin.
trying to help me go and open it.
Welcome back. Welcome back to NJ Discover Radio. You were just listening to Old Man Song by Nick Clemons and his band. And we're here at the radio station with Nick Clemons and all these guys. But I have a quick question I wanted to get in before Calvin went ahead with this show. There is an official day called Clarence Clemons Day, right?
Yes,
and
yes.
And this just was officialized of last year?
Well, last year... Jennifer Beck, State Senator, she came to us and she made the recommendation for it, and we were all for it. We appreciate the amount of support and love that the fans have for my father the years, and combining with our efforts to continue to do our charity work with the Big Man Fund, it was all a great topping to a great year just as far as his memory. And, you know, Senator... Governor Christie signed the day, and now it's an official day this year. It's our second time having the event, since celebrating his birthday, and this is the official day that it'll be on this January 11th, and we're going to have a great event in Martell's Tiki Bar. We hope everyone comes out.
And what's the date on that?
January 11th. It is going to be his birthday.
Okay. And at the Tiki Bar on the boardwalk.
On the boardwalk.
Point Pleasant, right?
Point Pleasant
Beach on the boardwalk. That's going to be fun.
Yeah, we're looking forward to it. We got some great friends. My father came out. We got John Caffrey's coming out. Michael Atune's going to be playing. Joe Bonanno and the Godsons. They used to rock the big man's back in the day, and they're still around here. And Joe's got some great music coming out this year. And, you know, my band will be playing, Nick Clemons' band. And, we have a reunion of a lot of Red Bank Rockers going to come out and do some songs with us, with the great J.T. Bowen. He's going to be playing some songs, and we're just all happy. Jack Scarangello, great drummer. It's a great Jack Scarangello. And Jeff Levine, Billy Rhines coming out. I'm going to say hi to Nancy Rhines. Shout out to her. More coming on every day, and it's going to be a great event.
Yeah,
great event. We hope everyone comes out.
Sounds awesome. We'll definitely be there, right, Cal?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
On the calendar, you bet. Absolutely. So, the next segment, we want to talk about Big Man's West, and I'm going to, before I throw it over to you, Nick, to introduce, I spent some time, because Nick and I are doing some stuff together, and I spent some time talking to an old friend of Clarence's, Candy Brown, and she was very cool, she was very sweet, very... passionate. So she kind of educated me a little bit about Big Man's West that was in Red Bank in 1980. Clarence started it, and some of the big names, John Bon Jovi, Garris U.S. Bonds were there. It wasn't an easy road, she told me, for Clarence to do this venture because it was Red Bank, and Red Bank is Red Bank. And mainly because it was in a residential area, So it was a kind of a hard thing, and helping, as Candy told me, helping Clarence out was his friend and manager at the time, Terry McGovern, who later became Bruce Springsteen's personal assistant.
Mm-hmm.
So she gave me a lot of interesting background, but I'm ill-equipped to take it any further. Why don't we turn over to you, Nick, and get everybody involved to do anecdotes of Big Man's West from 1980, Clarence's place here in Jersey, in Red Bank.
Well, I tell you, my father passed away in 2000, I think it's 2011, it's been a while, and I always kept looking for reasons, kept looking for to get all closer to his memory, closer to who he was. My father had a distance about him. He kept his privacy, but it was only through after his death that I realized who a lot of his close friends were, who were the people that he affected, and I learned a lot, built a lot of new friendships with people. George Memorial is one of them. I've seen George in a lot of events, a lot of community-based things that he's been supporting, and George just wants to tell a couple stories, because I know George used to be the manager of Big Man's, and I dragged him out down here to do something, and George, can you get a couple stories to yourself?
Thanks, Nick. I was managing for a while at the Big Man's, and I tell you, just knowing Clarence, he's a larger-than-life guy, as everyone knows. One time, I remember, and JT's probably remember this one too, where he took us all up to New York. And we had a bus, and everybody was in New York, and we're following. He's leading us around there. He's the one that showed. We saw the waitresses. We were like the VIP superstars. Every bar in New York just opened their doors, let us in. No standing in line, no paying any surcharges or anything. It was just amazing. I mean, Clarence was. The funny thing was, is he used to call me like Little Big Man, and he would. I remember one time I saw him in concert years later, and he could always make you feel so good about yourself. And he, you know, when I went walking into the tour bus, he was like, "Oh, wait, hold on, here's the real deal now. Here's the real deal now." And he made me feel like I was just larger than life too. So just hanging around him, it was quite infectious, you know, I felt like we were all a family there too, you know, JT and Candy and Bonnie and, you know, Tracy doing sound. A lot of the people that were there really went on and were very successful in life, and a lot of the bands like John Eddie and all that got a start there, and you know, sometimes they would be playing to, you know, 10 people or 11 people, and it was just you know, Clarence really, you know, he believed in helping out the local artists, and the production in there was fantastic. I'm sure JT would admit to that.
Yeah.
The sound and lights were just you know, they were just top of what was going on that day. The whole way the club was set up too was just a great thing, and there was also a front bar there, which was the fun, cool place to hang out when you know, if you weren't performing or before the acts went on and everybody was packed into the back. The front bar had all the, you know, we were sitting in there. Candy Brown ruled the front bar, and she was just amazing. And she's also larger than life, Candy Brown, and it was so much fun. I just never had a bad time there. Well, I'm sure I did. I just can't remember the bad time I ever had there. So it was great. But thanks, Nick. I am always more than happy to anytime. And your dad's, you know, involved in anything, I'll always help out, and I'm always there, so
George,
we appreciate you asking.
Growing up, you know, the bar was, you know, I think seven, so the bar was something we could never go to. It was just taboo, you know. I'd go there early in the morning, he'd go in to catch the register or something, you know, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, that's his morning, and, you know, when I first got back to playing music, and after my father had passed, I really went. Good shout out to Mr. Joe Bonanno, because he's been a great, great friend of mine, and he's guided me through a lot of pitfalls of this business coming back, and kept my head on straight. And Joe's managed to rock the Big Man's West. He's had some of the biggest crowds. He used to play there back in the day, and Joe's playing around the area now. Just got done playing the Wonder Bar for a show, and I know he's got a Christmas album coming out. We're really happy. But Joe has a story that he wanted to talk about. So I know he had some ups and downs in there too. But I know he had a lot of ups.
Yeah, we had a lot of ups and downs. You know? First of all, thanks for having me here tonight, Cal and Gene, Tara Gene. Yeah, I think probably one of the most memorable stories was I was laying upstairs in my bed, sick at home, and the phone's ringing off the hook, and I'm like, somebody pick the phone up. And I hear my father, somebody get the phone. You know, my mother gets on the phone. She hands it to my father. She goes, Clarence is on the phone. So I'm like, okay. Everybody back then, you know, was playing tricks before the Jerky Boys were even around, you know. So my father goes, yells up, Clarence is on the phone. Pick up the phone. I'm saying, Dad, come on, stop. So sure enough, I pick up the phone. He goes, Joe, this is the big man. I said, yeah. He goes, I know you've been hanging at the club, helping us, and I'd like to hire you as a house band every Wednesday night. I'm like, Wednesday? So this is September. And it's September, I'm saying, September. I said, well, so what's the pay? He goes, you got to work for the door. I'm like, I don't know. You know, this is, what kind of guarantee? He goes, no, there's no guarantee. So I'm like, Wednesday. I said, aha, it's the night before Thanksgiving. So that rolled. We built a good, decent crowd. And when Thanksgiving Eve came, we actually probably, I think we had 740 people paid at the time.
Wow. Wow. Yeah, that's a big
That was
night.
Probably bigger than opening night, which that was, as you remember, opening night was just a heat fest. You know, it was they did about five songs, and it was game called on kind of heat. You know, it was one of those things. It was, there was no, the air conditioning wasn't even working then. But for Thanksgiving Eve, yeah, we had I had John Bon Jovi came down and played with us, and it was a huge night. And it was great, you know, and Clarence was there, Bruce was there, and everybody was hanging out. And somebody just handed me a tape from that, actually.
Yeah. Wow.
Put it on CD, and it was a great night. So the funniest thing, if my son's listening, hold your ears. So I leave there, and, you know, collecting the money, what have you, and Clarence comes up to me, goes, God, you guys really packed it. But the sad thing was, he only had two bartenders working. They lost tons of money on the bar end, you know. And it was like, you know, worked out, though. But so he hands me this bottle of peppermint schnapps. He goes, here, happy Thanksgiving. I say, all right, good. Go get my clothes. Get in the car. I pull out a big man around the corner. And all of a sudden, I'm at the light, drinking it, chugging it right down. Right? I look to my left. There's a cop. I'm like,
oh my God.
This is not working. He goes like this. Roll the window down. I go, so put the window down. He goes, where were you? I go, why? He goes, where were you? What are you drinking? I go, schnapps. He goes, what were you just doing? I says, we just played at Big Man's. He goes, Big Man's? Throw it away. Go. I was like, today, dude, like, you know, I'd be in jail for years, you know. But that was one of the funniest memories that night. But that was a lot of good times there. A lot of good times with Candy and George and everybody that worked there. A lot of good memories.
That's awesome. I brought a whole crew out tonight. Thank you, Joe. I appreciate that. And another good friend, he's been a really good friend of mine, and has helped us out in the way. The first big man show we did, birthday show we did at Wonder Bar. Daryl Way, good friend of ours.
Hey, Nick, thanks for having me, buddy.
I feel
honored, you know, to be a part of this. It was a show back in Big Man's, freezing cold. And, you know, everybody, the roadies of the band, they're all trying to be cool, wearing their leather jackets, thin leather jackets. And the band just got off stage to a ripping set. Clarence walks in, full-length fur coat. Looks over at Gary Bang and says, man, the Bang's got some groove. And I remember, like, till this day, like, nobody had more groove than Clarence. And for him to say somebody's got groove, really made the night, you know. Mm-hmm. He enjoyed the show that much. And he brought us back. You know, we were there once a month to play the show, and the club was phenomenal. I mean, it was just, they made you feel, you know, the systems were great, the lights were great. It was a huge stage, huge dressing room. I mean, they made you feel comfortable playing there. You wanted to go there. No matter, you know, like George said, you know, if there was 10 people, you kicked that, you know, you kicked butt on stage because of the system, because of the way they made you feel there, you know. It was just a great place. He built a great place.
Yeah, we got a lot of the equipment back I got from my father passed me a lot of equipment back, and I took a lot of the old equipment because I wanted it. I wanted some of the stuff to have, and I got a lot of the speakers and the mic stands that say big BMW on it, and it's so cool to have, and it makes me really proud that I can still use some of that stuff, and it's just really impressive to have a lot of you guys here today, and I want to say a special shout and thank you to Mr. JT Bowens here tonight. JT, do you want to say a few words about the Big Man's West and the early days of the Red Bay Rockers?
Sure, Nick. Thanks again for having us here. I'm so blessed to be involved with this about Clarence. I met Clarence in 1960. He was going to college and I was in high school, and that's where our friendship started. And he said to me, JT, I was John Redding at that time. He said, Johnny, we're going to make it. And that stuck with me. And what I'm so proud about Clarence was that he believed. You know, he had a dream, and he lived it. You know, he was a good man. He really, if he told you something, you could take it to the bank. If he didn't like you, he didn't mess with you. And you didn't mess with him. You know, that's the way it was. And so that was in 1960. And then in the 70s, I ran into Clarence again in New Jersey. That was in Maryland where I first met him. And then in the 70s, I met him. He was playing with a band called The Chosen Few. And I didn't know. So I go to see The Chosen Few. Who do I run in but the Big Man? And we hooked back up. And then he left The Chosen Few. I stayed. Then he went with Bruce. And then we're moving now to the Big Man's West. I was in Philly. I moved back to Jersey. Ran into Clarence. He says, yeah, man, I'm opening up a club. You know, what are you doing? I said, nah. He said, well, would you work the door? I said, sure. You know? And so I worked the door for a while. Then he comes to me again. I go to his house. He says, I'm putting a band together. I want you to sing, which is the Red Bank Rockers. So, you know, I'm so blessed to be affiliated with Clarence. And then I'm affiliated now with his son. And when I look at Nick, I see a lot of his father in him. And, you know, I'm just so blessed to be here. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's coming back to me. this is all sentimental. This was, like, wondrously sentimental stuff. I love listening to this. I could listen to it all night, which is a good time for me to talk about a song that Clarence recorded. And most folks here in America don't even know about this. So I did some research, I interviewed and did my due diligence and discovered that Clarence recorded a song back in 1981 called They're Still Christmas. And I got to do the right justice to this and set it up the right way, because there's a lot of synchronicity in my getting involved in doing this. But there's a wonderful movie that comes out, and this is Christmas. You know, we're a couple weeks away from Christmas because we're live here. And there's a wonderful movie that I must have seen about 150 times called It's a Wonderful Life. And I write about that movie all the time, and I love that movie. And what's kind of tied in here is the fact that the angel in that movie was Clarence.
Ah.
Clarence Oddbody, if you remember the movie.
Yes.
So see how I see how my mind works?
Yes.
So anyway, then I was given the information, and I tracked down Dennis Burke and Jim Nuzzo, who were composers and lyricists. And back in 1981, they went ahead and they wrote this song, and they really wanted Clarence, who wasn't a vocalist, but they wanted Clarence to do the song. They approached him. Of course, he was with Bruce at the time. They approached him. They met in Seabright, at Clarence's place in Seabright, and he agreed to record the song, There's Still Christmas. And he was really into it. I think the first recording session he came wearing a cowboy hat, which was okay, but then he really got into it. And the next recording session, he wore a Santa's hat. And so Clarence really got into the song.
I think there's a couple of bottles of Jack with that recording. Made
it work. Wow. And see, and
right, I understand.
I wasn't going that way. And it's funny that you brought that up, Nick, because
well,
I was
I'm
taking,
the only one that talks about booze here.
I was taking the high road, and watch where I was. The next thing I was going to say for recreation while they were recording, they played video games. So, but you brought up Jack, and I'm sure, you know, Jack was around. Jack Frost and Jack, the other guy. So, but anyway, the song was recorded, and it's, the reason why I brought up It's a Wonderful Life, because that's a Christmas classic, and I got my own theory. As more and more people learn about this song and know about the song and discover it, this, even though, so Clarence is giving back to us now. From 1981, he's given back to us, because we're going to listen to the song. Actually, obviously, I'm setting it up now. Mm-hmm. And you're going to hear his deep baritone voice, and it's a beautiful song, because the words and what it means for what it meant for Clarence, that, you know, things can go wrong, but there's always Christmas. You know, whatever can go wrong, but there's still Christmas. So without further ado, and you can always find this on YouTube, folks, because it's not, I mean, it's out there, but it's a wonderful song. So
it's
let's,
on iTunes, so you pick it up, I believe so.
Yeah, on iTunes. So let's listen to There's Still Christmas.
When all the world seems cold and lonely, like the midnight snow, and hope is hiding somewhere in the stars. Just listen for the sound of sleigh bells ringing through the night, 'cause someone's on his way to let you know there's still Christmas, and the joy that Christmas brings to everyone who'll open up their heart. There's still Christmas, and the song that Christmas sings, like peace on earth, goodwill to all, silver bells and deck the hall. So don't forget, when you feel lost, there's still Christmas. And when dreams fade like candlelight through frosty window panes, and memories sound colder than the wind, just look above the rooftops for an old man and his sleigh, 'cause if you listen, you can hear him say, there's still Christmas, and the joy that Christmas brings to everyone who'll open up their heart. There's still Christmas, and the song that Christmas sings, like peace on earth, goodwill to all, silver bells and deck the halls. So don't forget, when you feel lost, there's still Christmas. Stockings on the fireplace, the warmth you feel inside, mistletoe and candy canes, the look in children's eyes. There's still Christmas, and the joy that Christmas brings to everyone who'll open up their heart. There's still Christmas, and the song that Christmas sings, like peace on earth, goodwill to all, silver bells and deck the hall. So don't forget, when you feel lost, there's still Christmas.
What a voice. He could have been a real vocalist, you know?
Beautiful song sung by Clarence Clemons called There's Still Christmas. You can find that on iTunes. You are listening to NJ Discover Radio. To find out more, go to njdiscover.com and follow us on Facebook on the NJ Discover production page, and you can also follow us on Twitter. Just to let you guys know, we are airing right now. December show is the Sandy Storm anniversary show. where we have the world record for the largest sandcastle. So that's the show that we run Wednesday nights and Saturday afternoon at 12:30. So you want to tune in that, to that, because that's our December show. Don't forget to tune or check out our website of our sister company called Artist Nation TV. We've got some great interviews on there with musicians, authors. The most recent one is Matt Wade and Richard Hoynes, author and photographer. So check that out at artistnationtv.com. And we're back in the studio with Cal and with Nick Clemens and...
Friends. A lot of friends.
Lots of friends.
All musicians, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so it gives me, I want to jump right into Joe Bonanno. And Joe, if you could take some time out and do an intro and talk about your Christmas song, Your Love Is All I Want for Christmas, and how it came about. And so take the mic and run.
I have the mic. Okay. How it came about really was, I guess over the probably the last 2 years, I was kind of tired of hearing the same, you know, Rock Around a Christmas Tree, sang by Joe, blah, 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 and another one of another version. I said, you know, we need another Christmas song. So I started writing one, and it just, the time didn't work out, the time frame. You know, I guess it was just too close to the holiday, and I didn't have time what I was doing. So this year I set forth, and my friend, the Soul Cat, by the way, I'm going to give him a little plug, kind of pushed me. He says, you got to do a Christmas song. You got to write a Christmas song. So I had it in my mind, and every day I would work on it a little at a time, and it just all came to me real quick, you know, and I knew to feel what I wanted and just the tempo and everything, and I got together with the guys at my band, God Sounds of Soul, and said, we're going to do this, and I was very fortunate to work with a great engineer, Rob LeBret. He's Bruce's house engineer at the studio, and kid's got great ears, great talent, and he co-wrote the song with me, and we got it out. And it's been picked up by a couple of radio stations.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. Can I say the names?
You sure can.
WCBS-FM.
You sure can.
101.5. Is that okay?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
I don't want no dirty looks here.
No. We're a talk show here, so you can bring up all the music stations you want. We just do talk.
And numerous cable stations. My good friend Dave Kapolsky, who's one of your lawnsmen.
Yes, he's a lawnsman. Yes.
He's been pushing it for us a lot on WBIG. Throughout down South Jersey, which is great.
You know, it is great.
And we're doing it for Little Kids Rock. That was one of Clarence's favorite charities, and Little Stevens. And
talk about the charity a little bit.
Little Kids Rock. It's a organization, and it helps underprivileged children throughout our country, which is good. Raise money for in musical instruments, music lessons.
Mm. Nice.
You know, singing lessons. And it's a great organization.
Truly.
Yep.
Yes.
And just to help out with them. And all the net proceeds from the download and the physical sales are going to that.
Okay.
Nice.
Yeah. And on the 21st, can we go to that segment?
Yes. Okay. Do it.
On December 21st, I'm going to be doing it with the Gary U.S. Bonds Band at the Count Basie Theater in Red Bank. And it should be exciting. Looking forward to doing it. Darling Love's also on the show.
Oh, great show.
And this new up-and-coming artist from the Asbury area, Gideon Luke.
Sure.
I know Gideon. Great mm-hmm. band.
Yes.
Young Sly and Family Stone.
Yes.
And he's on the show. And Pat Guadagno.
Sure.
And a couple other good artists. It's going to be fun. It's going to be a great night.
It's a great show.
Yeah.
And that goes for Little Kids Rock, too?
Yeah, that's the big concert.
Okay.
And the CD will be available there out in the lobby with everybody else's CDs. Well, but I encourage everyone, please. I mean, it's only $2.99 we're selling the physical CD for. So,
in the process.
Where can I get the CD?
CD now, it's will be available at our live shows, but unfortunately, next show we're doing would be the 21st.
Is it online anywhere?
Yeah, exactly. iTunes and cdbaby.com.
Okay.
You could check it out and just, you could Google it, or Your Love Is All I Want for Christmas.
Okay. Which is a good setup, so let's entice...
Oh, wait, I can't forget this.
Okay.
I mean, I had my daughter, she walked in the studio and, you know, from bringing the raw tracks home, she was listening to it and, you know, Dad, I could sing this. I said, well, Eve, I mean, we have somebody singing it, which is Jody Bon Jovi, Jody Joseph was on her singing some backup. Sure. She goes, I could sing because that's her voice teacher. And I said, I don't know, Eve, let's come in. So she walks up to the mic and Rob puts the headphones on her and says, come on, start singing. She just started singing. It was like, oh, my God. You know, it worked out great.
Yeah. Wow.
And I had my son on there also doing some backup vocals. So it was like a family project.
That's great.
I
got to
make everybody happy.
That's nice.
You know,
nice.
It's Christmas time and everybody's happy.
A lot of love put in
the
song.
Yeah, it's good.
What a gift for Christmas to have your family work on a Christmas song that you wrote.
That's a gift in itself. It's a good feeling. Yeah, it definitely is. Darryl.
Good for you, Joe.
It's perfect.
Yeah, it's cool.
And what's to make it even more perfect, let's listen to it now.
Let's listen to it. Spend it away.
Mr. Engineer, your love is all I want for Christmas.
Joy everywhere, and people hustling through the chill. The twinkling lights may be shining bright all over the city tonight, but there's something I'm missing in my soul. Is all I want for me. Young carolers, they sang those joyful melodies. Your spirit warms the air, spreading peace and harmony. A Santa's bells may be ringing at night, a jing, jing, jingling, a jingling bright, but there's something. Something missing in my soul. Oh,
your love
is all I want for Christmas. And I don't need no presents under the tree. Oh, no. A little mistletoe wrapped in a big red bow. That would be the cue if I should stay or go. Oh, your love is all I want for Christmas. Prices gifts from three wise men, but I tell them over and over again, your love is all I want for Christmas. All I want for Christmas. It's all I want for Christmas.
Oh, your love
is all I want for Christmas. Oh, your love is all I want for Christmas. Oh, and I don't need a new guitar or the fancy red Cadillac car. Just your love. It's all I want for Christmas. All I want for Christmas. All I really want for Christmas. All I want for Christmas. All I want for Christmas. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa.
I have 10 seconds coming in.
Okay, we're back. How come I don't hear myself? Okay, now I do. We're back. Nick, couple of reminders for everybody listening about what's happening on January 11th. Why don't you go down the list?
Oh, yeah, great song, Ray Songer. I had to say that.
By the way, it was a great Christmas
song. Thank you,
song.
Thank you.
Yes, truly.
Woo!
Good song.
Yes.
January 11th, we're going to celebrate the big man's birthday. It's going to be at Martell's Tiki Bar. The roof will be closed for you, Mr. Devine. And tickets will be $25. There'll be drink specials all night. It'll be a great special Martell's buffet, and you guys all know about that in Point Pleasant. 7 p.m., the doors open. It'll be a Friends of My Father's, other artists paying tribute, including John Cafferty, Michael A. Tunes, you can't beat that. Joe Bonanno and the Godsons, Nick Clemens Band, and a special reunion of the Red Bank Rockers. They're going to come up and do a few songs with the rest of the bands. J.T. Bowen, Jack Scarangella, Jeff Levine, Billy Ryan, and more. And again, it's a celebration of the big man's life. There's going to be a lot of also local acts there. A lot of local musicians there, people we know that have shared the stage with my father over the years, Gary Bangs, Eddie Testa, my good friend Slim Chance and the Gamblers, Mary Casello and Eric Green will be there, Killer Joe from Long Island, a lot of our New York players coming down, and Steve Barlotta, Bam Vinny's Edge, and good friends Mike Huntley and Mike Rocket, Tommy Byrne will be there. From On to Something, and it'll all be hosted by Brian Anthony of WFAS from Orlando on the Morning Show, and special guest DJ Willie Marecki. And it goes 7 p.m. to 1 a.m. Tickets are on sale at Martell's and also online at www.ncbproductions.com. And you can call 732-948-2491 if you want tickets. You call our production company, it's Ask for Sue. And, again, if you want to come down and you're coming from a long way, we have people calling from Europe, we got people coming from California, they can get a great room, great rate, the White Sands Hotel, and they can dial 888-558-8958 for any reservations. Again, I appreciate and thank Martell's for having us, and I appreciate Cal, you, and, again, I appreciate everybody here for coming out today and supporting the event, and at times like these, you know where your love is, where your friendship is, and where your heart is, and I truly see it tonight, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you
very much. I want to introduce my friend Mike Alicia, news member of Nick Clemens Band, is going to help us play a song, and I think JT wants to say a few words before we break into this one.
Yep. JT, say a few words about your song, and also tell us what you've got coming up for yourself.
Starting the 18th, I'll be at Count Basie Theater with Mark Ribler and friends. We're doing the 50 Licks thing. Then doing Quincy Mumford on the 21st at the Stone Pony. And, of course, I'll be with Nick on the 11th. And right now, I think what you want me to do is a song that Bruce wrote for Clarence. Very beautiful song entitled Saving Up. So if I can get Brother Mike here to help me out. Oh, yeah. You may have diamonds, you may have pearls, you may think you got it, baby, over all the other girls. But honey, you ain't got nothing, and I'll tell you why. If you're empty as a soul can be, baby, deep down inside, you better start saving up all the things that money can't buy. You better start saving up for the things that money can't buy. You better start saving up for the things that money can't buy. You better start saving up for the things that money can't buy. You may have a big backyard and ruby ring, and my love's just a second place runner, honey, to your fancy things. But what you got to hold on to when the lights go down, when you're feeling so bad, baby, deep down inside, you better start saving up for the things that money can't buy. You better start for the things that money can't buy. You better start. You need a strong man, baby, to love and understand you. A man who ain't afraid should get a little dirt on his hands for you. Ooh. And when you're feeling so downhearted and all you wanna do is cry, oh, come on, take my hand, baby. Together you and I, say we can start saving up for the things that money can't buy. You better start saving up for the things that money can't buy. You better start saving up for the things that money can't buy. You better start saving up for the things that money can't buy. You better start saving up.
Nice.
Woo!
Wow.
Wow.
See everybody on the 11th, huh?
So nice. Yes.
This will be an official Clemens family celebration, just letting y'all know that. And thank you, JT. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you all for having
Mike.
Me.
You guys are awesome.
That was great. Thank you so much for singing for us.
This has been sumptuous. One of my favorite words.
Sumptuous.
This has been wonderful. Before I say anything else and we do our little sign off, I do have to go back because someone brought it to my attention. I do have to go back to There's Still Christmas. The song back in 81 was written, the lyricist was written, it was written by Stevie Betts. And Dennis Burke was the melody guy. And Jim Nuzzo was the arranger and the producer. And they got manager Matty Brewer, who was the assistant tour manager for Springsteen, to approach Clarence Clemens. And that's how this whole song came about. And there's my friend, the engineer, with his two fingers up. And everybody, did you see that? That was Nixon's. That was Nixon's sign. And I say this all the time. That was Richard Nixon's sign. Anyway, This has been great. It's
yeah.
a great night.
Thank you so much for coming,
everybody. This
Thank
has been
you
wonderful.
So much.
It's absolutely Thanks, been wonderful. Today. A special, special, special night for a special man and for a bunch yep. of special people who are all here. Mm-hmm. So this is our last show
for the year.
Yep. We're both gonna
take some time off.
Okay. We're gonna come back in January, and we have a few things that we're thinking about doing, a show about adoption, because that came to us from celestial places.
Yes.
We won't get into it now.
Right.
And we want to talk about the man, Ed Jarrett, the Sandcastle man who mm-hmm. did the Guinness World
Yep, he can tell us how he did it.
Yes, and Hometown Hero. So mm-hmm. we have a lot of interesting shows planned for January, et cetera, et cetera. Tara Jean Vitale, I'm wishing you and everybody here
yes.
a merry and a happy and a healthy, all good things, always and always.
Thank you, Calvin, and you too.
You too,
yes.
Cal.
Yes, thank you.
Merry
you
Christmas.
Too, all
happy
good things,
holidays.
Everybody.
Happy New Year.
Ho, ho, ho.
Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. And thanks. Please send us messages on Facebook and contact us because we'd love to hear from you.
We're going out with the Christmas song.
Great idea.
Great. Be safe.
See, that's our
Be
big
safe.
Boss guy over there.
This
idea.
Is great. Yeah. Cut. Wrap. Boom.
It's a wrap.
I
all is
to talk
well.
About the CD, but that's all right.
all
Do we still
well
have time?
And,
oh, When all the world seems cold and lonely, like the midnight snow, and hope is hiding somewhere in the stars. Just listen for the sound of sleigh bells ringing through the night, 'cause someone's on his way to let you know there's still Christmas, and the joy that Christmas brings to everyone who'll open up their heart. There's still Christmas, and the song that Christmas sings, like peace on earth, goodwill to all, silver bells and deck the hall. So don't forget when you feel lost, there's still Christmas. And when dreams fade like candlelight through frosty window panes, and memories sound colder than the wind, just look above the rooftops for an old man and his sleigh, 'cause if you listen, you can hear him say, there's still Christmas, and the joy that Christmas brings to everyone who'll open up their heart. There's still Christmas, and the song that Christmas sings, like peace on earth, goodwill to all, silver bells and deck the halls. So don't forget when you feel lost, there's still Christmas. Stockings on the fireplace, the warmth you feel inside, mistletoe and candy canes, the look in children's eyes. There's still Christmas, and the joy that Christmas brings to everyone who'll open up their heart. There's still Christmas, and the song that Christmas sings, like peace on earth, goodwill to all, silver bells and deck the hall. So don't forget when you feel lost, there's still Christmas.